Welcome everybody, welcome from OncoSTEM to the fourth virtual scientific meeting. Thank you all so much for sparing the time and attending this meeting. And of course, a very big thank you to all the doctors who are working so fearlessly during this pandemic. Our heartfelt gratitude from the entire team at OncoSTEM. Thank you. Today's speaker is Dr. Ramakant Deshpande. Although he needs no introduction, I will attempt a very brief introduction. Dr. Deshpande has over 37 years of clinical experience in the surgical management of various thoracic, pediatric, and breast cancers. He is involved in clinical and basic research and teaches undergraduate and postgraduate medical students, nurses, health workers, and also lay people. He has over 60 publications in various national and international journals. In 2014, the Government of India honored him with the award of Padma Shri, which is the fourth highest civilian award for his contribution to the field of medicine. We welcome Dr. Deshpande and thank you so much for this talk, sir. A virtual round of applause to start with for Dr. Deshpande, and over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. Normally, it's customary to say that, okay, it's very nice to have met on this weekend, but I guess last 3.5 weeks have been completely weekends for us, so it's a little difficult to keep track of the days also. So anyway, it's nice. So today's topic actually is regarding precision medicine and a very vital way of reaching precision medicine. And how I as a clinician actually see it. I am not a molecular biologist. I am not a lab man. So the technical details of many of these parts, I don't deal with directly. But what do I see the whole thing as? How important is it? You know, my career actually started, student career started in the late 70s. And that time we did not have all these mutation studies, etc. And in fact, today's topic can actually form a very, very interesting topic if somebody is ready to write a story of an English movie where somebody goes to sleep in 1980 and wakes up in maybe 220. So whatever you used to do at that time is precisely the wrong thing that you would do it today. Why is it so? Because we have today realized that cancer is essentially a genetic disease. It's not only an abnormality in the anatomy, nor and only in the physiology. And most of these genetic diseases are caused by either the mutations or rearrangements of the genetic material. And integration of this genetic science into actually clinical practice is known as precision medicine. In a very abstract way, this is almost like putting up somebody's horoscope. And our understanding about a horoscope is almost the same thing as what we have about precision medicine. We do know a lot, absolutely no doubt about that. And we can actually make very, very good suggestions, very good practicing kind of decisions, but we don't really know everything as yet. Because the reason is very simple, is most cancers are genetically complex and better defined by activation of signaling pathways rather than a defined set of mutations. Next. Next slide, please. Yeah. All this started actually in the last 15 or 20 years, and it actually started in 1990. And the whole government, all the intelligent people around the world, they started saying that, no, we must have a genome because everything starts from the gene, whether it's a malignancy, whether it's a benign disease, whether it's a nutritional problem, so on and so forth. So the human genome was started in 1990. They initially had thought that it will take about 20 years, but it got over just in about 13 years. Original thought was there are more than 130,000 genes in the human body. Finally, they realized that there are only 30,000. And they determined the entire DNA sequence. You can see here the figure on the right side. I don't even know how many zeros are there, but all this data actually became available to all of us. Understand one thing, the first genome was synthesized in 13 years with billions of dollars. And today we can actually do the same thing in just about 24 hours within $1,000. So that is the progress. That's the rapid strides of human science. Next. So as we all know, the whole material of genetic transcription, etc., is actually laid out on the DNA strands, which run as parallel, as intertwining strands, and the nucleotide sequence is what decides as to how exactly we are going to develop or what is going to ultimately turn out to be a human being. And when you actually try to analyze this nucleotide sequence, that is what is the genetic analysis. Next. It would normally take a hell of a long time for doing this analysis, but because of certain technical advancement, like the next generation sequences, which is, as we go along, we'll actually see it, through a four-stage progress, it can actually give us the reports just in a few days. First and foremost is, yes, you take a sample. Obviously, without a tissue, you can't really do anything. And there are various platforms. Now, somebody just now said that there is a new platform which is there, which is incredibly accurate. So you have multiple platforms and which can actually take the processing where you actually prepare a library, which is like a basic kind of a reference point for comparison later on. And that can actually take anything from 6 hours to 3 days. Then it goes to the NGS platform for sequencing of the genes, where actually all the details are really worked out. This could also take a few hours. Then it comes for quality analysis, that what you have actually sequenced, whether it is correct or not, whether the depth is good or not, specificity is good or not, so on and so forth. And then you get all the data. Now, once you get the data, the most important is the first three things. Even I can actually do it if I see a technician doing it. And where will I get stuck is actually the level four. That is the interpretation of the data. Humongous amount of data is actually generated, and interpretation of that will differentiate one laboratory from another laboratory. So it all depends upon how sound is your library and how sound is your analysis. So this is what is very, very important. Why you need to choose a good place to send your tissues to for analysis is basically because you need a good lab to give you a good direction. This is almost like getting a compass. You are ready to sail your ship, and you are asking for a compass to a laboratory. And if your compass is not good, you just don't reach there. Next. So the options earlier, like Sanger sequencing is a way of sequencing, except that it is fairly slow. You can actually do a single gene analysis. It has relatively higher operating costs and laborious protocols. And that's why it prevented the widespread use in clinical laboratories. This was absolutely the thing till 2005, when Roche came with a new platform, and that actually helped the NGS, which allowed simultaneous analysis of multiple genes or genomes with high throughput and low sequencing costs. You know, how do you compare it? It's like when you are actually studying for your MBBS, you have maybe about 8, 9, 10, 11 subjects. So you have to do them sequentially. So suppose you can actually do everything simultaneously, and if you can finish off your MBBS in just 1 week, can you imagine how greatly beneficial it would be? Obviously, this is only a theoretical thing, but this is what an NGS actually does for us. Next. The benefit of personalized medicine in oncology is, as we said, that the genetic science, when you integrate it with clinical medicine, you can use it in multiple ways. You can use it as a predictive oncology. You can use it as a diagnostic oncology, a prognostic oncology, or even directly for therapy. There are multiple uses. Only thing is, your results need to be fairly accurate. Next. So the options of analysis are multiple. You can have a systematic analysis of whole genome sequence and whole exome sequence of tumors. This is important, because what happens is, what kind of abnormalities are you likely to get? Yes, you will know that when you compare it with a standard one, you will find three different types of abnormalities. One is, either it can be totally as a part of a normal tissue, or there could be an abnormality in the genetic sequence where either there is a mutation, an abnormality, or there is a translocation. Whatever is supposed to be there is not there, but it's elsewhere. So you could have a translocation. Now, the abnormality can be actionable, which means that you can have actually a medicine which actually can act on that particular area, and it can reduce the size of the tumor or control the disease for a fairly long period of time. Number two is there are sequences which will actually tell you, like a KRAS mutation, where you the targeted therapy is just not going to act. It tells you that. So the first thing is like EGFR will tell you that yes, you can actually use a drug here and it will help. When you have KRAS, it will tell you that no, doesn't matter whatever you use, it's not going to help. And third one is almost about 40% is you have a mutation, you have a variation of unknown significance or VUS, and that forms almost from 40 to 50% of the times in tumors will find that VUS exists. So there are targeted genome profiling, there are transcriptome sequencing, there are tumor normal comparisons, and you can have rearrangements, copy number alterations, etc. These are all technical things about which I can't really speak much. The lab people can speak much more, but what can happen is when I get a report, it will tell me clearly whether I can help the patient with a medication or I can't help the patient with a medication. Next.
Sir, just one request. Can you take the mic closer to you, your mouth, please?
Okay.
So only the mic, sir, if you have the, or that's fine, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Right.
Thank you, sir.
So the clinical utility value is multiple, you know, detection and identification of somatic mutations in hematopoietic tumors. And actually speaking, rather than us solid tumor managers, actually it's our medical oncologists who use this facility much more commonly because they can actually set up targeted therapies in a much better way. So we can also have hereditary cancer predisposition syndromes in clinical oncology. So the predictive biomarkers are usually either the direct target of inhibitory drugs like estrogen receptor or HER2 or molecules involved in DNA repairment or polymorphisms of gene involved in drug metabolism like thiopurine, etc. The most successful targeted therapy in this field is seen in the members of the TKR family, that is the epidermal growth factor receptor, EGFRs, and EGR2, and also non-receptor messenger molecules such as KRAS. So as I mentioned, this actually is the highest level of success what we find. Next. Okay, so how is actually NGS we can use from diagnosis to follow-up? It can go through multiple levels and all this information is possible only by next generation sequencing, which can give us the report fast. You can actually get almost the same information by Sanger sequencing, but it is going to take an unduly high expenditure. You are not going to get the depth of same kind of an information, nor is it going to be of the same cost. So how do we really work it out? You decide the clinical diagnosis is made, you take a sampling, then you send it for assay. So you ask for the target gene panel. So you can ask for the whole exome or whole genomes. Now there are clinical situations where patients have undergone all kinds of treatment and what we call as a center for difficult cancer. So it may be a very, very abnormal kind of a cancer, very, very unusually seen, or somebody who has consumed all lines of conventional kind of a treatment, and then you fall back upon your genetic kind of a whole genome assay. So the sampling method could be one of the three, like conventional, the paraffin block, or you could ask for a fresh frozen, or it could be a cell-free DNA in the peripheral blood. Now it goes to the laboratory and then we get the result as what I had shown you just now. Again, you can see here in between that you can actually have a mutation hotspot, an actionable variant, or a prognostic value. This is how you do it. And then you start with the targeted therapy. You could use the patient for the clinical trial and you can avoid unnecessary therapy. For example, if you do not have EGFR mutation, then obviously using a TKR targeted therapy is not really going to be of greatly help. So that is why it actually focuses you to use your complete intelligence and help the patient in saving the time as well as expenditure. Now, once that particular thing is done, Now, suppose the patient responds very well, then you can continue monitoring. Then how can NGS come into your help later on? Then liquid biopsies, you can actually do that. That you could actually take maybe about 7.5 cc of peripheral blood and you could do liquid biopsy. Cell-free DNA can be actually be assessed and you can monitor resistance. You can actually see a sequence for resistance mutation. Like T790M, if it comes up when a disease is actually growing, then you can adjust the therapy as dictated by the result. So this is how you use NGS from diagnosis to follow up. Next. So let me just give you an example in management in lung cancer as what I was saying. Now suppose there is a lung adenocarcinoma. Now not all adenocarcinomas are obviously the same. There are limited number of actionable genes here. In case of Western population, EGFR positivity is maybe about 15 to 18%. In case of Asians, it's almost about 26 to 28%. KRAS, if it's positive, then your targets are not just going to respond at all. All the other ones are maybe 1 or 2%. ALK varies in from series to series, but it could be anything from 1% to almost about 8 to 10%. So it all depends upon the sampling method. One of the best advantages of NGS, unlike in Sanger sequencing, is you can actually do an information, get an information even on a small piece of biopsy, even on a true cut biopsy, you can get the same kind of an information. So you can get a quick information on small biopsy results and you can actually plan for the whole treatment. For example, just a true cut biopsy is good enough to you for you in case of a stage 4 malignancy where the patient is not really that fit to kind of do a thoracoscopic biopsy or an excision of a larger piece. So you can actually get a large piece, I mean adequate tissue, and you can get a bioinformatics. So suppose if it's EGFR exon 19 is showing an L858R mutation, then you can actually check it and then you can understand that it's an actionable mutation hotspot and you can begin the therapy with erlotinib. So this is how it is going to, and in about 60 to 80% of the patients, you will find a reduction in the tumor size. You will find a definite reduction in the symptoms of the patient. And in fact, you may find improvement in the survival as what we will actually see later. Continued monitoring, what happens is clinically, if the patient shows an increase in the disease in size or progression somewhere else or metastasis elsewhere, then you can actually do a liquid biopsy rather than going for an aggressive biopsy. And this is quite often required. For example, if a patient is operated, you don't really see a primary anywhere, and suddenly a patient comes with a brain met or only a bone met. Now, these are not locations where you can do biopsies very easily. So liquid biopsies actually can actually help in these kind of patients. So when you monitor resistance, and if you find that there is an EGFR L858R or T790M mutation, then you can switch erlotinib to some other drug, which will actually start working on that. And you can continue the monitoring. Now at some stage, if the disease keeps on progressing, you are going to see mutations which do not really have any kind of treatment as of today. But you know what happens with every step, even a stage 4 malignancy, you can practically get almost about 2 years of survival. Now, can we imagine this, that in 1980 or 85, we used to tell a stage 4 malignancy lung cancer patients to go home and get lucky. That's it. 6 months to 8 months used to be an average survival. Then came chemotherapy. The survivals went from 11 to 16 months. And now we have this amazing kind of an NGS application with targeted therapy, which can actually help patients survive for years together. And just imagine for a busy professional, if you can get 4 to 5 years in a stage 4 malignancy, you can, how much can it really benefit? Next. So the usefulness is in diagnosis. There is a specificity with accuracy. The tumor subtype can be differentiated by behavioral differences to response. For example, adenocarcinoma with EGFR mutation will behave differently from adenocarcinoma without one, exactly as triple negative breast cancer is different from hormone receptor positive ones. So today what is happening is two identical patients
will not be treated with same kind of a treatment, because today you have there the molecular biology map in your hand. So this is how you can actually differentiate between two sets of patients. There is a therapy identification. For example, EGFR negative tumors will not respond to erlotinib no matter what you do. So this is how you will eliminate unnecessary treatments and expenditure. So thirdly, identification of cause of resistance, as I mentioned just now. But this can happen at two locations. One is resistance at one location, which is called as a point mutation, like in EGFR therapy in lung cancer with T790M. And this is totally different from a complicated epigenetic regulation where everything totally changes, like in glioblastoma in EGFR. So all this is possible to do only because you have NGS today in hand. Next. The utility value of the NGS platform also, you can plan clinical trials. Today, what used to happen is you can plan, while you are planning a clinical trial, you would say that, all right, let me have cancer of the lung, EGFR positive and EGFR negative. I will do trial of this particular way. Now, today, what can happen is, and those kind of treatments used to be umbrella kind of a trial, like it's only on one patient or a group of patients with one identical kind of a thing. Today, what you can actually land up doing is, rather than taking anatomy as a focus, you can actually take the molecular diagnosis of the tumor. For example, you can have a colon cancer and a melanoma, both BRAF positive, and you put them in a basket and you can actually run a clinical trial. So this is what is very, very important to realize. And this is what you can actually realize, and you can run the clinical trials. So you can actually run clinical trials based on the molecular diagnosis rather than only the anatomical kind of a structure. And you are very likely that your ultimate results are going to be much faster. Next. Now, while talking all this time, we are actually speaking only of the gene panels. Now, sorry, the single genes. Now, you can actually run gene panels. For example, multiple genes, 60, 70, 80, 200 genes like that you can do. You can actually sequence the whole genome and find out what exactly is happening. There are packages which are prepared. So you can actually do that, and that will help you from diagnostics to prognostics and from prevention to treatability. Now, obviously, this is possible only by NGS. You cannot really use any other method. And there are examples. For example, a needle biopsy of thyroid, quite often in about 20% of patients, doesn't even give you a clear idea. But the thyrosequence gene panel includes driver genes and alterations frequent in thyroid, was applied to 143 fine needle aspiration samples, out of which 91 were retrospective and 52 were prospective. And they had known surgical outcomes. 104 were benign, 39 were malignant nodules. And when you actually did the study showed that there was 90% sensitivity and specificity, accuracy with 83% of positive predictive value and 96% negative predictive value, which is much, much more than clinical value of 20% negativity. So this is very interesting. Transthoracic fine needle aspiration in lung cancer and endoscopic ultrasound guided fine needle aspiration in GI tract tumors or other primaries prove efficient to identify actionable and clinically relevant mutations. So this is also a very, very interesting thing. For example, you can do a TrueCut biopsy, and suppose EGFR today, there are trials of using the TKR the medications for the neoadjuvant therapy, and many times you will see that they almost cause the same amount of reduction in the size of the tumor. There are reservations, there are problems in using targeted therapies for preoperative kind of preparation of a patient. But I think over a period of time, as the quality of the treatment, the quality of trials improve, I think hopefully the patient may actually be spared the problems of and the difficulties of chemotherapy altogether. Same thing can be done with rectal cancer patient. Next. So gene panels also prove suitable in identifying mutation profiles with prognostic potential. So they are able to predict the progression of pre-malignant to malignant lesions and to better classify tumors after surgery. For example, there are specific mutation in gene AS and KRAS could predict the progression of intraductal papillary mucinous neoplastic lesions to pancreatic cancer. And mutations in KRAS have prognostic value in pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma. Now, all of us who actually treat these kind of relatively so-called viewed benign kind of lesions, mucinous papillary carcinoma, non-malignant lesions, we are keep them into observation. But suppose you have specific mutations in that tissue, in these genes, then you would probably treat it with much more aggression. So you can actually differentiate two types of patients where one type of a tumor will proceed with pancreatic cancer. So you are going to operate upon them. And the other one, you can actually keep them under observation because they do not have the mutation. Similarly, in case of gastric hyperplastic polyps, now this is not a very uncommon thing at all. In clinical practice, you have a lot of gastric hyperplastic polyps. And if you do the 40 gene panel, you can actually predict with which one of them will go through dysplasia and then adenocarcinoma. And if you subtype it as the type which is likely to get into adenocarcinoma, you will actually do a partial gastrectomy for those patients and prevent the malignancy from occurring. So this is like being forewarned is being forearmed. So this is what is important. Same thing can happen in about oral cavity squamous cell carcinomas, which can identify mutation patterns that correlated with disease-free survival. Very, very important. If your pattern shows that there's a long disease-free pattern, survival and good prognosis, then you probably may not really treat them with aggressive kind of adjuvant therapy. And if you identify several actionable mutations, then you would use that kind of a medication for treating of the patient. Next. Now, you can see here that you can identify inborn genetic disease, or you can identify risk factors. You can do maybe screening. You can identify those patients who are likely to develop malignancy. For example, what we do in case of BRCA1 and BRCA2 is very, very similar. You know, a young lady who's maybe 20 or 25 who actually shows positivity, you are not going to run and do a surgery on her. But how you are going to treat her breast cancer is definitely different from how you are going to treat her impending ovarian malignancy. So breast is something which can be examined regularly. So if she is somebody who can remain under regular checkup, then in that case, you would tell her that, okay, finish your family first. And maybe by the age of 40 or 42, you undergo a subcutaneous mastectomy with reconstruction. Angelina Jolie has made this abundantly famous. So that is how it is. But ovarian malignancy, if at all it occurs, is a different ballgame altogether. You may never be able to catch an ovarian malignancy early. So what you do is you don't really run into doing a oophorectomy very early in life, but you go ahead and actually do, you ask her to finish her family and do excision of her ovaries along with the tubes sometime by the age of 40, because that is the age which is supposed to be a risky kind of an age. So in case of actual disease, you do a diagnosis, prognosis, and therapy like what I mentioned just now. Residual disease testing is something which we can do. Resistance mutation surveillance is what we can do. Next. So these are the targets, the mutation, the structural variations, the epigenetics. These are all the things which can be done. And the gene expressions, which actually are used by the labs. Next. NGS is actually effective for all size scales. You can see here the lowest one line is based on the base pairs, the size of whatever of the tumor or whatever is the mutation. NGS is good for everything. Next. In case of lung cancer, the targets are multiple. The point mutations which are there are the EGFR, the G7, the KRAS, the PIK3, BRAF, etc. Small deletions are the EGFR exon 19 deletion. Copy number alterations are the MET amplification, EGFR amplification. The gene fusions are the ALK4, RET, ROS1, and NTRK1. So there is a host of the things, almost about 60% of adenocarcinomas of lung will actually show it. And even in squamous cell carcinoma, in almost about 4 to 8%, you will find some kind of a mutation. But what is more important is the PD-L1, which can also tested, is becoming very, very important for immunotherapy. Next. So when you're looking at traditional methods, the NGS is definitely more sensitive than Sanger sequencing, as I mentioned. It's more cost effective, improved turnaround time, tissue preservation. This is very important. Potential for discovery of novel actionable targets. See, because you can do things faster, because you can do the, run the whole sequence, you will actually be able to identify the mutations of unknown significance, of the varieties of the unknown significance, which are very, very important, because you can focus your research on that. Today, if we have an actionable mutation, any kind of a drug against KRAS, that will probably take the cake. This is what is important. And a lot of research is going on against KRAS mutation. And the flexibility of analysis types is very, very extreme. Next. But at the same time, you know, as I showed you the machine, which is very, very sleek, but it's also very expensive. The cost of implementation to set the labs is in crores, even in India, even today. In the Western Hemisphere, well, a million means only a million, almost like it would mean equivalent to almost about 50 lakhs of rupees. Here, it is almost like in crores of rupees, which is still a small lab cannot really implement this kind of a program. Secondly, more important is significant requirement for informatics infrastructure and expertise. This is extremely important. You can actually receive a lot of information. As I mentioned, even somebody who's basically very naive as far as a lab is concerned like me can go through the first three steps. If I just work as an assistant to a laboratory technician, I can get into those three areas. What do I do about the fourth one, where interpretation is very, very important? And then there comes the expertise. So most of these labs which are there will have a lot of PhDs, some of them like 80 to 100 PhDs. And that is how it actually makes their quality better. I don't know how many hundreds of PhDs somebody like Foundation would have, because their work is very, very large. But important to say is pick your laboratory very, very carefully, because one is the expertise needed, and secondly, the rapidly changing nature of technologies. You know, the platforms are changing very, very fast. You know, there is no standardized guideline available for data analysis, interpretation, and reporting. Libraries have to be there, so on and so forth. Finally, you know, all this costs money. You know, today, complete gene reporting is sometimes can go to see all the variations, etc., can go up to 3 lakhs of rupees in India. So there is an uncertainty of reimbursement. Many times what happens is, if you, by the time you finish off all your options of treatment and come for a difficult cancer treatment, you will have finished most of your insurance. And if you can't really afford to pay maybe about 3 lakhs or 4 lakhs with an uncertainty of reimbursement, now this also becomes an obstacle for further research. And finally, you know, uncertainty of clinical utility. Market competition is very good, but what happens is unhealthy market competition also sometimes can kill research initiators. Next. Now, this is something very, which most of you will have known, that the T790M positive, if you pick up a correct medication, the survival is likely to be better. Next. One of the other things which can actually be analyzed very well with NGS platforms now is this liquid biopsy. Now, what is liquid biopsy? Is use of blood, and you can use it for in two ways. One is either you can find the circulating cells, the tumor cells, or you can also find cell-free DNAs. See, the tumor is quite often heterogeneous. So you can do a needle biopsy, but you may not actually get a representative kind of a mutation in that particular part of the tumor. And you will come home thinking that this patient does not have actually any kind of a mutation, where the real thing may totally be different. So tumor cell-free DNA actually addresses to this problem, because the tumor through all its parts is throwing the cell-free DNA. And what the NGS platform does is you can actually analyze everything, put everything together, take only the positive findings, and actually select out the negative findings. So you can actually identify, detect the resistance mutations. You can use it for targeted therapy, response to the therapy. You can identify recurrences, and you can even the mutation 1 or mutation 2 can be identified. Next. Now, clinical sensitivity in case of liquid tumor also will depend upon tumor types. You can see here that in case of bladder, the yield can be more. In case of glioma, obviously it's going to be very, very less kind of a thing. So the liquid biopsy is not something which is good for everybody. So some malignancies, it's very good. Some malignancies, it's not going to really show you any effort at all. Next. So you can actually do the biopsy, you can get your result, you can target the therapy or the chemotherapy, whatever it is there, and you can monitor the recurrence based on the cell-free DNA. Next. You can see here that the mutant fragments per 5 ml will actually indicate to you 2-year survival. And I am aware that many of the leading medical oncologists today are using cell-free DNA as a matter of routine 3-monthly or 6-monthly kind of a monitoring, particularly when the patient has undergone a difficult kind of a treatment, a large surgery, or a difficult kind of a treatment, multiple treatments, or something of an unusual kind of a treatment. They use the cell-free DNA, and NGS is something which gives them the result very fast and very reasonable. Next. You can see here that, you know, EGFR mutation positive, once you give Jeftinib, you can actually make the patient survive a little longer in a better way. But if mutation is negative, giving Jeftinib is of just of no use. So it is actually identifying the cell, the patient population, which is going to be benefited and which is not going to be benefited. Next. Same way, ALK4 translocation on crizotinib, you can see here that the one which has mutation positivity will actually do better rather than not. Next. One of the interesting things, if you really see, what does the cell-free DNA do? I mean, when you do a identification, if you go from right to left, you know, actually the resistance, when it is coming up, you can identify it almost like 4 or 5 months before the clinical clinical increase in the disease is actually coming. There is almost a gap of almost about 3 months, so you can identify that the patient is going to recur almost a few months before, and be ready to actually treat the patient differently as soon as the time comes. So you can actually prognosticate patients differently. Next. And the same thing you can do actually for melanoma. You can see here that if you identify them differently, you can actually make out which patient is going to do better and which patient is not going to do better. Next. Now, based on all these, there are several FDA-approved targeted therapy drugs which everyone knows, like breast, there is Herceptin and Perjeta. In case of colorectal, you have Erbitux and Vectibix. Gastrointestinal stromal tumor, you can use the Clivac. melanoma, you can have a different BRAF mutation targeted kind of a therapy. In case of non-small cell carcinoma, you have multiple medications. Ovarian malignancy, you have a specific tumor, this thing, specific medication. Next. In case of Canada, now Canada is a little more conservative. So you will find here that the number of drugs is slightly on the conservative side. But the by and large, the US FDA and the Canadian FDA is not much different, though the number of drugs are highly, highly selected in case of Canada. Nick? So where do we stand now? Can NGS eliminate traditional pathology? I mentioned that yes, you can actually put them in a basket and you can run a clinical trial. So we should be able to eliminate, and one day we should be able to say that no, we don't really need a pathologist. We just need an NGS laboratory and the technician who can prepare good samples. Can we do that? Obviously not. But can we have precision medicine without NGS? As of today, we do not really see any possibility of that happening. So today we have to have a combination, and it is very important. All the clinicians must realize that you have to have the basic knowledge of NGS. You must understand what is the genetic constitution of your patient, and whether you're going to operate or not operate, whether you're going to give chemotherapy or not chemotherapy, whether you're going to radiate or not radiate a patient, you must have all the information in your hand before you undertake the definitive treatment. It's like what Walter Disraeli said, that ultimately the man who has the maximum information at hand will win. This is a formidable enemy, and unless and until we have all the information, it's very, very difficult to take an informed kind of a decision. Next. Thank you. Now, where is NGS acceptance in India is what is important. Now, NGS is here to stay. And I think we have enough number of people, highly specialized people, who are practicing precision medicine. And most of them are medical oncologists. Our chairperson today here, the moderator, is one of the finest consultant that what we have. And there are a few people everywhere in the leading cancer centers. But understand one thing, what you need to do, this is like understanding a language. You could be in Timbuktu and still understand that language. So this is something which can actually be practiced. Because essentially, if you really understand, if you remember your movie Star Trek, the best fighter was Yoda, who was 800 years old, but he never fought physically, he fought with his mind. So he fought with his knowledge. And this is what is important. Precision medicine has everything to do with knowledge. And this is what is very, very important to realize. A lot of precision medicine is being practiced in case of the plant biology, in case of microbiology, and hundreds of papers are coming out. Very good material is coming out from leading centers like Tata Hospital and several other centers, Delhi, Chennai, Hyderabad. A lot of these centers, they have actually accepted NGS as part of their studies of the malignancies. There are a lot of good laboratories which have come up now, which actually do it in private as well as in government sector, where this is becoming very, very common. In fact, one of the finest labs I saw was in Karnataka University in Dharwad, where the vice chancellor was a geneticist, and he had an NGS lab, and he would do the BRCA1, BRCA2, and the other genetic parameters of the local population for 1,000 rupees. And this is very, very interesting. So yes, we have this kind of a familiarization, and this is what is important, that this science must progress, and there is no way that we can actually escape not knowing this science. Purvesh? Okay, there are several questions here now. Let me just go through them. It's okay. I'll go.
Parikh sir, can you just try your audio once?
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Sorry. I was on mute. There are several questions and Dr. Amish Vora was the first one to ask. So if he is still there, can we unmute him so that he can ask the question?
Amish sir, I'm just unmuting your mic. Please go ahead, sir.
Hi. Thank you, sir. It was a nice revision of NGS in 45 minutes. Am I audible?
Yes, Amish.
Yeah, go ahead. Amish, you are...
Amish, sir, can you hear us?
So I can repeat the question if you can't hear him. He was saying...
I can see the question here. But
hello, can you hear me?
Now we can hear.
Sure.
Okay, sir, you are in your day-to-day practice.
Yeah.
Say last 5 cases or 10 cases where on imaging and clinical examination, the cancer is absolutely operable.
Yes.
Can you think of any of the case scenarios where you have changed your decision to operate based on NGS report or in terms of surgical oncology, still we are not there in April 2020 as regards NGS and surgery?
No, as of today, see, as far as the curative potential is concerned, even today, surgery, resectional surgery in a fit patient, fit willing patient is still the best chance of cure. So if the patient lesion is absolutely operable, then I think I will not really change my decision based on the NGS. Now, there are clinical situations. Almost 30% of my patients are beyond the age of 70. So technically, it may be a very, very operable kind of a thing, but the patient is a borderline. Somebody who has had a 2 heart attacks, ejection fraction of 25 or 30, where, you know, a few years back, I would have said, okay, let me try it. I may be able to get away with that. But if I find that today, if it's a mutation positive kind of a thing where I can use a TKR, and if the patient does not have other problems against kind of those medications, then probably I will change my decision. So yes, operable, but you know, borderline kind of can, the operability, then I will probably change the decision in these kind of patients.
Also, Amish, Raman showed a slide in which there was a evaluation of the margin positivity in melanoma patients. So that could also be a future application for lung cancer as well.
Yes.
The second question that we have was from Dr. Satish. Can you unmute him, please?
Hello.
Dr. Satish, I'm unmuting you. Please go ahead, sir.
Hello. Good evening, sir. It was a very nice talk, sir, from Dr. Deshpande. Sir, my question is, we are doing so many NGS in the lung and colon. We may be having a little more chance of targetable drug. Do you recommend NGS in all some certain subset of cancer or in all the cancer or some few indication all in the recurrent and advanced only setting or upfront? That's what one question. And we are doing so much of NGS, but clinical meaningful benefit is hardly 10-15% as per my knowledge. Like I think you'll be having a better output input from your side.
Yeah. If you take a basket of malignancies and then if you look at how many times your NGS has actually made a difference, maybe about 15 or 20%, you are absolutely right about that. But you know, I talk from the point of being a clinician. So that is the point where I'm saying that yes, 20%. But if you have, see, there, what is the point against NGS? Today is the cost. Now, what we are looking at, yes, it costs so much. Now, the same thing used to be with ER and PR. But today, nobody really thinks of treating a breast cancer patient without ER and PR. And that actually would be an inadequate kind of a information at hand to take any kind of a decision. And the way I see it, NGS will eventually become like that. Secondly, all these variations of unknown significance, the VUS, will start getting narrowed down significantly as more and more methodologies of treatment will start coming. And It's very interesting, but there is a time when you start focusing on the RNA kind of activities, RNA analysis, there is a possibility that off-label medications also may start coming in. Who knows? I mean, you may treat malignancy with probably chloroquine someday. I mean, I'm not angling at the COVID thing, but it's possible off-label treatments could actually become the in-label kind of treatment. So what we need is, we need information. And that is, from that point of view, I think NGS is useful. Whether the patient can afford that kind of an expenditure or not is something the clinician can decide. Or if you can average it out and ask the labs actually to reduce their cost over a period of time, because the number of analysis is going up, probably eventually with all that information, you will probably, we have the picture right in front of us. We are not able to see it today. And suddenly it will suddenly appear, like how the jigsaw puzzle fits into place.
Right. Also, only 15% of the patients might have an actionable mutation. The decision is helped in all 100%, because in the remaining 85%, you are not going through the expense of giving an unnecessary treatment. So I think even today, it benefits in 100% of patients, because it helps our decision-making process. Anil Poddar.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Anil Poddar has a question. Thanks. Can we unmute him, please?
Just 1 minute.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm unmuting your mic. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, but Raman, I have heard you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, Anil, tell me.
Yeah, I have heard it was an excellent presentation. My question was, in a metastatic disease, after using one line of TKI, if there is a metastatic disease which is a biopsiable lesion, and still do you do the liquid biopsy? The only advantage of doing a liquid biopsy in this situation, that you can negate the heterogeneity of the tumor. What's your take on that?
Right. No, I'll tell you one thing. Liquid biopsy is a matter of convenience. You know, like suppose your patient comes to you after operating on a cancer lung. And then he says, I have a lot of cough. You've done a PET CT scan as a matter of routine. That there is an uptake coming up in the mediastinum. Now, you know that, yes, it is biopsiable. It's a little difficult, but yes, your radiologist can do that. But what happens is, all that still takes logistic planning. Whereas liquid biopsy is, you can tell the patient, okay, walk into the lab, they will take your blood right away, and in 4 days, you will get your biopsy report. So, the ease of getting a liquid biopsy is something very important. Well, understand one thing, that the importance of liquid biopsy is if you can get a positive result. If you get a negative liquid biopsy result, please go ahead and biopsy that particular patient. Don't leave him just like that, because you may be missing out on something which is actually targeted.
All right.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right, Dr. Rajesh Singh had a question. Can you unmute him, please?
Hello. Yeah, good evening, sir.
Rajesh, hi, how are you?
Hi, sir, how are you, sir? Sir, very informative lecture, and it was so nice of you that you talked. Sir, I would like to know, is there any role in day-to-day clinical practice where you have felt that probably in routine follow-up of cancer patients, can liquid biopsy would have been better or add on apart from routine biochemistry and imaging?
I think that eventually it will come to... surveillance is going to become part of our life at some stage or the other. Today, why are we really worried about liquid biopsy? Because it costs. It costs maybe about 20,000, 30,000 rupees, Whereas a CT scan costs maybe about 5,000 or 7,000. But suppose the liquid biopsy were to cost us maybe about 5,000 rupees, we would not really be discussing this. We would actually be using it as surveillance. Now, having said this, I am aware that there are leading oncologists who actually are using liquid biopsy for follow-up and surveillance, not because they are sold out on liquid biopsy or anything, but they believe in the utility value of the liquid biopsy. So along with everything else, if the liquid biopsy also is falling in way, just as I showed you one slide, actually, that a mutation actually shows up almost like 4 to 5 months before radiological progression. Yeah. So, liquid biopsy is going to give you a certain amount of advantage. There's no two ways about it. And just a matter of time before it becomes, see, ultimately from a point of insurance company, for them also to treat a patient early is definitely better. So today, suppose there is an insurance patient, and if the insurance company is open to, you know, reimburse that, you do a liquid biopsy for surveillance.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Next question is Jakula Kishore. I hope I'm pronouncing the name correctly. Can you unmute him, please?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes,
please go ahead, sir.
Dr. Ramakant, sir, thank you very much, sir, for giving a glimpses of this precision medicine. Really, it's a real eye-opener for surgeons like me, which is away from the mainstream oncology development. Sir, I have a silly question.
Sure, there are no silly questions.
Sir,
all questions are good.
Okay. Any normal person can walk through the lab like Oncostome or any other lab to get NGS done for giving a small sample of his blood and get his genetic profile and know the risk of developing future cancer. Is there something like that with this NGS? Any advantage?
Yeah, surprisingly, yes. You know, actually, I don't know the great accuracy of it, but there are panels, labs of worth their salt always have their own panels to identify a risk of developing cancer based on the patient's history. And yes, there are those My Cancer panel, and there are other every I'm sure our host, today's host also will have some kind of a panel there. And anybody who's otherwise, see, this happens to all of us, can like you're, as you said, you're a surgeon and you know you're treating a malignancy. Yeah. And he's a young fellow, and his brother will say, oh, then what is my risk profile?
Exactly.
You know, so you can actually ask for that kind of either a blood test or maybe a gene test or whatever it is, and you can actually identify their increased risk, yes or no.
Actually, benefit.
After all, what you're doing in a BRCA1 and BRCA2 is exactly the same, isn't it?
Yeah, you can get rid of this excitement or the apprehension from the attendants, which are giving us a lot of trouble. So we can shift that anxiety to the lab. Thank you.
You know, in a very small way, in clinical thing, like, you know, the polyposis coli, he comes, you and with him his brother comes, you also tell the brother to undergo a colonoscopy.
Exactly.
So on the other side, this is exactly the same thing in another part of science. It's that's all.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Great. Next is Anil Hero has a question. Can we unmute him, please?
Please go ahead, sir.
Good afternoon and an excellent lecture as usual, sir.
Thank you, Anil.
So I just had two questions. One was a follow-up on Amish Vora's question about the surgical part. So one thing was, like BRCA 1 and 2 is influencing the decision of surgery. About whether to do a mastectomy or whether to go ahead with a breast conservation. Will NGS come to that extent? Will it influence local treatment as well?
It will.
Secondly, will the turnaround... Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
Will the turnaround treatment, turnaround times, I mean, this is whether they will change, because right now the turnaround times will not allow us to use it for any kind of pre-surgical workup. Secondly, how many times do you think that really treatment decisions have changed in early operable? You have operated a breast cancer, early non-metastatic cancer, whether NGS really has made, do you even feel the need of doing an NGS in these times?
See, it all depends upon where you stand. See, ultimately, this early breast cancer could be in a patient who is, say, 45 years of age, whose one sister has undergone breast surgery and she's BRCA1 positive. This sister also is BRCA1 positive. What would you do? Would you do a conservation or would you do a subcutaneous mastectomy? So you will obviously change your the decision. There is no two ways about it. At the same time, you may also do excision of her ovaries and tubes at the same time, laparoscopically, which is basically a no-brainer. So yes, in some times, I mean, it is not very common. Secondly, any breast cancer which occurs in a lady less than 35 years of age, BRCA1, BRCA2 is slowly becoming an indication. There are two things what you have brought up which are very, very important. One is the turnaround time, and second is the cost-benefit ratio. Now, cost-benefit ratio is a temporal kind of a question. The costs keep falling, the benefit keeps on increasing. So at some stage, you are going to actually cross into the realm of being beneficial. That's one. Number two is how often are you really going to do this particular thing? I think the way I see it, it is probably going to become a routine kind of a thing, maybe about 20 years later.
Great. 20
is just an arbitrary figure, but at some stage in the future, it is bound to be there. I mean, when I started my medicine, I passed my MBBS in 1976, and there was no ERPR at that time. And if I had gone to sleep and woken up today, Anil, you would have laughed at me that I don't know what the ERPR is.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Sir, we have, so if the question is done, we have Dr. Krishna Mohan. You can just... Sorry, sir. Please go ahead. Hello.
Yeah.
Krishna Mohan is there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I'm there.
Please ask the question.
Yeah. Sir, I have a practical question, sir.
Yeah.
Suppose there is, and thank you for the lecture, sir. Thank you, Purvesh, sir. A practical question is that there is a patient with lung cancer stage 4 adenocarcinoma presenting upfront, and I have asked for an NGS.
Right.
And NGS shows a rare mutation, let us say some mTOR inhibitor mutation is active.
Okay.
Which is not generally practiced nowadays. So right. In this situation, what is the appropriate step in the first line of treatment you feel, sir? Should we choose that mTOR pathway or should we do the regular chemotherapy and then look at it when the patient relapses?
It all would depend. See, ultimately, there are indications. Suppose even in a fit patient, what you're saying is an unusual kind of a thing. But suppose even if when you're waiting for a mutation study to come in, there are specific indications for chemotherapy. For example, an impending kind of an emergency is one kind thing, like a neurological or a CNS kind of a problem that way. You will start the chemotherapy immediately and then you will wait for that mutation study to come. Here, what you are seeing, giving a situation is it's a stage 4 malignancy. mTOR is there. Now, understand one thing. mTOR, I don't know what are the kind of results which are available, long-term results which are available for an unusual mutation response treatment. But if you take EGFR, if you take the ALK mutation, etc., there's practically a doubling of an overall survival, which I suppose mTOR also should actually technically give that kind of a thing. If you don't treat stage 4, survival is 5 to 8 months. If you treat them with chemotherapy, it's 11 to 16 months. And if you use a targeted therapy, it practically doubles. So I would say that if there is no emergency in that patient, like an impending paraparesis or something which is causing pressure on the brain stem or something like that, I would probably target the patient with a targeted therapy.
Excellent. So just to add to that, I think it's very important to understand that these mutation testing, molecular testing, have to be applicable in the Indian context. If you remember several years ago, IRSA came into the picture for management of lung cancer. And it almost was rejected because the percentage of EGFR mutation in the Western Caucasian population was only 5%. It was thanks to the very high incidence in the Asian population that it became useful. And we are having major benefit as opposed to the Caucasian population. So also, if you look at ALK testing, outside in the US, the percentage positivity is only 2%. Whereas in here, there are some areas where it is as high as 12%. 12%. So also for breast cancer, you know, there are so many examples that Raman has shared with you. But this is all information based on what is happening in the West. I think if we have some data of our own on Indian patients, then it would make a big difference. And one of our future webinars will be focusing on the benefit of these molecular testing, for instance, CanAssist, on Indian patients, Indian data, and how it has benefited. Coming back to the question, Satish Babu has made a suggestion that there is a cheaper sequencer available, and he has put the information on for everybody to see. Can I move to Piyush Bajpai for his question? Can you unmute Piyush Bajpai, please?
I don't have him.
Okay. Then there was one more question by Amish Vora. Can you put unmute him?
Sure. Amish, sir?
Yes. Yeah, Amish.
Amish, sir, you
have? Yes. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Sir, the question, in fact, what I had asked earlier in continuation of the same. Say a case of CA ovary, stage 3C or stage 4A, pleural effusion, which is positive for malignant cells.
Right.
you have referred this patient to a medical oncologist. We have given 3 cycles of neoadjuvant chemotherapy, and there is an excellent response. Meantime, we also do a BRCA testing on a germline BRCA mutation, which turns out to be positive. Patient comes to you with this report, and we know the trial which has taken operable versus not operable CA ovary for maintenance olaparib. As a surgeon, based on this NGS report, are you comfortable that all these patients can be put on maintenance olaparib? Because stage 4A and majority of stage 3C, even if they are completely surgically resected, the median PFS is around 12 to 18 months in the best of the hands. Would you be comfortable using that NGS data and saying that no, go for maintenance olaparib and I would not operate on you?
See, what you need to do is you need to evaluate the two sets of people where in, say you take two patients, one identical situation where one who's resected, one who's not resected. You will find that even late stage disease, locally advanced or late stage disease also, when you resect completely a disease, they generally do better than those people who are not resected. So this is what is important. So then comes the evaluation of a risk and the load of that particular decision on the patient. If it's not a very fit patient, then obviously there's no question of offering surgery to that particular patient. But if it's a fit patient, if you feel that the patient is likely to get benefited by surgery, then you would offer surgery and then go ahead with the targeted therapy.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Just continue, sir. How many of stage 4A pleural effusion positive CA ovary, if you have operated even after neoadjuvant chemotherapy, have PFS beyond 16 to 18 months versus if you see the trial where the PFS is almost, the hazard ratio is 0.25. So, if the germline BRCA positive. Yes, sir.
I think you have a very important question, but we should not forget that the benefit of neoadjuvant chemotherapy is only if the main treatment is given, right? And in this same example, you are trying to compare one with the other where there is no evidence.
No, what he's asking is, should I replace?
No, there is evidence, sir. There is evidence.
Is there a direct comparison? No, no. Is there a direct comparison? For stage 3C, you change from stage 3C to 4A. So I'm asking you, which one you are asking, 3C or 4A?
Inclusion criteria of solo one trial, one of the inclusion criteria was that patient completing 4 to 6 cycles of chemotherapy and germline BRCA mutation positive, and if the surgeon has found to be inoperable, the patient can be put on maintenance olaparib, and these patients are inoperable and operable, both surgeons, both in the trial.
There is one rider there. So if the surgeon is found inoperable, which means, sir, that the debulking is not going to be adequate. See, stage 3C, there are two situations where you can actually take out the disease to a microscopic level because you remove all the peritoneum, everything. So if you can do a complete debulking kind of a disease, generally they would do better. Ultimately, the peritoneal excision score is what will matter ultimately. And that is what is going to decide. So you can by and large decide whether you will be able to do that preoperatively. Your clinical estimation will tell you whether you think that it is possible to do it. And if the response is superb, which means that there's hardly any disease there, then I would operate. If the disease is still there quite a lot, bulky disease is still there sitting, which is likely to need a bowel resection and all that, then I would not operate.
So Amish, I'll just like to answer it in a slightly different manner. For a patient who is incurable, for a stage 4 disease, for instance, our intention is to prolong good quality life as long as possible. And as we have seen in so many diseases, sequencing of treatment is better. So it could be that neoadjuvant chemotherapy, surgery, and then maintenance olaparib might give the best outcome to the patient. But it will be your case-to-case basis decision. And as Raman said, it would depend on several organ and patient factors as well.
Understood.
Great.
I think Satish has asked a question.
So, yeah. Is Satish asking a question? Can we unmute him?
Hello.
Yeah, Satish, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, answer like I know that NGS is real is changing our practice day to day. The issues when you're dealing with in the OPDR and counseling, that it is not mainly majority of people are insured people, they are questioning is not covered under. Is there ever anything associated from like can we ask the insurance company to get involved? That's one thing. Like is things or anything is happening or not? That's what I'm asking, sir. Because it's not covered under insurance.
Some of the NGS is actually the BRCA 1 and BRCA 2 will be covered. But, you know, when you're asking for a complete genome kind of a thing, it's quite expensive. It runs in lakhs. So that is why the insurance companies sometimes do not cover it. But, you know, Oncotype DX and all those which are like 2 lakhs, 2 and a half lakhs are being covered slowly and steadily. Though, of course, it doesn't come into NGS. But they are covered because it's a good prognostic kind of a disease. Anything which helps you in making a better decision, and NGS definitely falls directly into that, they should actually do a reimbursement for that. And if the company has not done it primarily, then you have to write to them explaining them how exactly it would have helped. And if in spite of that, if it doesn't happen, then probably I think going to a ombudsman or something like that has to be done. I'm sure the Medical Oncologists Association can actually write to the insurance companies and help to resolve this issue. But this is a very, very important thing. Like I mentioned during my talk also that this is a problem.
Please go ahead, sir.
Hi, sir. I just wanted to ask that many times patients, you know, when they read about targeted therapy and they still have to take chemotherapy, they really ask questions like if the target therapy is possible, then why do we need chemotherapy? Then what do you like? How do you counsel these patients?
I think I should direct this question to Purvesh, who actually answers this.
Sure. So counseling is exceedingly important. And I think counseling can be divided into before ordering the test and after the test results are obtained. Before ordering the test is important because the patient should understand the limitation essentially. And like Satish had said that if it is positive or actionable only in 15% of cases, patient should not feel that you know we have recommended something that was not useful. The second time of counseling is for hereditary cancer because it is not just one individual but the entire family which will have to be affected. And therefore, counseling requires training, and fortunately, there is a molecular counseling society in India and there are about 35, 40 qualified and trained counselors. So we should not have a problem anymore about that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
All right. So like... are there any other questions?
I think I'll just read one question which we got from Dr. Piyush.
Yeah.
What sort of counseling consenting should be taken from patients where we send NGS?
So I think that was a continuation of the question that Rashi asked, that counseling is important and the consenting of the patient should essentially only be limited to saying that I am aware that this test might, and the word might is important, might help in my decision process. And the decision process should not be specified further. That decision process could be related to individual, could be related to family, could be related to surgery, radiation, chemotherapy, and so on and so forth. As long as he has consented for doing the test and we have documented that, it should be okay. But really, coming back to the most important thing is that we have to decide how to treat the patient based on our own reports and our own data. Because the mutations are different. Even if you look at a simple, so-called simple gene like BRCA1, where there is data that has been collated over for more than 25,000 patients, even here, there are mutation variations between Asian population and Caucasian and Hispanic population. So, and the benefit and the efficacy is also different because it's not like a Mendelian dominant inheritance that everybody will have the same outcome. Therefore, I think it is very important that we focus on our data, and that is how we should move forward. And I hope that the next webinar that we do on molecular oncology will be more focused on Indian specific data and Indian validation, which will help us in do this in a better job. So with that, I will go back to Dr. Raman Deshpande for the concluding comments. And on behalf of all the participants, there were more than 85 participants. I really thank you from the bottom of my heart for doing such a fantastic job.
Thank you, Purvesh. Actually, what is important is to know that NGS is here to stay as one way of doing a genetic analysis. This is very, very important to for everyone to realize that today, if you have not done a genetic analysis, and NGS being the most common way of doing it, then you are actually not offering a correct kind of a treatment to the patient. This is what everyone, be it a surgical oncologist, be it a medical oncologist, or a radiation oncologist, must realize. Secondly, what also happens is, this also brings into focus the importance of multi-speciality meeting before taking a decision about the management of a patient. It's all very nice to say that, okay, this is a breast tumor, I will treat this particular thing in whatever way I want. You know, normally there should be no competition between a surgeon, medical oncologist, or a radiation oncologist, but that's how it happens. So these things cannot really be allowed to go on anymore, because the NGS, with its knowledge of genetic medicine, will bring so much of value that if you don't put that value into the treatment of the patient, you're actually missing out on something. So this is what is important for all of us to realize. Yes, it is not the best science. It is not a know-all kind of a science as of today. But which science is like that? It has to undergo progress. And the more we use it, the better it is going to become. And who knows, sometimes we keep on talking, you know, we keep on seeing the letterheads, cure cancer, and so on and so forth. The cure, if it has to come, it has to come through precision medicine. So that's what I personally feel. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And over to the host for OncoSTEM for giving any final vote of thanks or comments.
Thank you, Dr. Parikh. Thank you so much for the excellent moderation. And thank you, Dr. Ramakant, for the superb talk. I think we had excellent participation and a lot of doubts were cleared. And again, from OncoSTEM, thank you to all the doctors for the brave work you're doing during the COVID pandemic. Please stay safe. Thank you. Thank you for attending.
Thank you very much. And bye.